All right, now I'd like to introduce Erica Lorentz. Erica comes from Boston. She trained with Janet Adler, who was her mentor for 20 years. And she did active imagination through movement starting in 1975. She studied dance movement therapy and got her degree in 1980. In 1998, she became a Jungian analyst. And her thesis is what this talk tonight is based upon. So she's done this work for a long time. And she's currently a training analyst at the Boston Institute. We'd love to invite her.
So, Tevin, thank you for inviting me to the Jung Society, and welcome tonight. This is my thesis, which I've talked about since 1998. Actually, I first presented it at the Oregon Jung Society in 1999 or something. And I just want to let you know I will be talking about some client experiences, and I have permission to do that. Can you just follow me again? So the reason why I feel like this topic is so important is we talk a lot about archetypal material, but we don't talk about and we don't know what to do with, and we don't have a cultural context for archetypal phenomena in the body. And that's when people go to psychiatrists and get medication, which could be important, but can really also screw up our relationship to our body. So Jung talked a lot about the body, actually. In every volume of the collected works, I have an index in the back that I made of the body, everything he said about the body. So if you ever want to know anything about the body, you talk to me. He was the one who really began to bring, of course, into Western psychological thought the whole spiritual dimension. And he, in the Zarathustra seminar, if you want to look it up, is where he talks about it a lot. When he talks about Nietzsche, he had a very ambivalent relationship with, if anybody's read the Zarathustra seminars. They're pretty amazing.
Yay, Terry! Thank you, Terry.
To bring the right one. There we go. Okay.
Now I won't get lost.
I've actually given this talk so much that it keeps morphing, so we'll see what comes out tonight. Okay. All of us know, the modern age, we're in a crisis. We're very alienated from the self, the body self, the soul, our ecology, the web of life, which of course are all interrelated. And we have these body-mind splits and spiritual normal splits were very split up. And Jung, of course, when he split with Freud, he went through his own journey, which we can all read in the Red Book. How many people have read the Red Book? Okay, yeah. What did you think? I would love to do a book group with the Red Book. I read it in 6 weeks, and I could not finish the book because I had to teach it. And the candidates, and the last 11 pages, my psyche just couldn't read it. That's it. And it was the worst course I ever gave because I had not integrated any of it. So I was just sort of lost. Jung considered the Red Book his Rosetta Stone. And he, from the Red Book and his experiences, that's how the rest of his work unfolded, to try to understand and come to terms with what his experience was and how to use it in his work and for people. And of course, that's where he discovered the individuation process. And we have to remember that Jung worked with psychiatric. He worked with schizophrenics, where Freud worked with hysteria, whatever that is. And so he had a very different relationship with the archetypal world, and as a child, of course, he had many amazing experiences himself. So Murray Stein, in 1992, wrote, "We must recognize that the Jungian revolution offers an enormous opening for research and investigation and practice into regions that have been largely taboo or pathologized in psychoanalysis, namely religious experience, visionary states of many kinds, parapsychology, and so-called magical practices and occult wisdom, and all forms of human spirituality." By the way, I really like to speak in a Socratic way so I can get what you're wanting and understanding. So feel free to say, what are you talking about, or ask me a question, or and I'll move us along, okay?
And speaking of that,
we're
not going to have a break, so if you need to take care of...
If you need to go to the bathroom, feel free, take care of your body. But we'll just keep doing this. So what we're talking about is embodied experience. Jung said you cannot transform without bringing it into the body. It doesn't work. We can talk about it, we can read about it, we can conceptualize, we can analyze, but unless it's in the body, nothing happens. When the body, the mind, the soul, and the spirit all come together, that's when we have that shift. I'm sure everybody knows that. So the embodied experience is energetic, it's emotional, and it is the body-mind. Jung wrote, "And so, individuation can only take place if you first return to the body, to your earth," speaking of nature and the earth. "Only then does it become true. Individuation can take place when it is realized." You know, the tree in the forest, who does the tree, you hear the tree if you aren't there, or does the tree fall? I can't remember how that went. "When somebody is there and notices it, otherwise, it is the eternal melody of the wind in the desert." So this is why we need the body. The body also protects us, tells us when it's too much, and we can say, whoa, stop. He says, "The body claims equal recognition. It exerts the same fascination as the psyche. If we are still caught in the old idea of an antithesis between mind and matter, this state of affairs must be unbearable. But if we can reconcile ourselves to the mysterious truth that the spirit is the life of the body from within, and the body is the outward manifestation of the spirit, the two being one, then we can understand why the striving to transcend the present level of consciousness through acceptance of the unconscious must give the body its due, and why the recognition of the body cannot tolerate a philosophy that denies it in the nature of spirit." Get all that?
Yeah. Where is that from?
This is from volume 10, page 94. And he also says, "The body is merely the visibility of the soul, the psyche, and the soul is the psychological experience of the body." So it's one and the same thing. I'll read that again. "The body is merely the visibility of the soul, which is the psyche. And the soul is the psychological experience of the body." So they're just different sides of the same coin. That's from the Zarathustra somewhere. So we can't make a spiritual experience happen. We can't summon the archetypes, right? They come when they will. Over Jung's door in Kusnacht, it says, "Called or not called, God is present." And we can't say, "Would you please come now?" Many of us want to do that and try. We can only make a kemenos, a space for it, and also sometimes we just get hit over the head with it. And we have to go into the unconscious like Jung did in the Red Book. So Jung explains individuation, and he talks about this personal part of the unconscious and the collective unconscious. And the personal unconscious, of course, is developed in our early life, and the collective unconscious is that which we emerge from into our body ego. And he also talked about the collective unconscious is the objective unconscious. It has a, it knows, it's bigger than us. It has us, it speaks to us as through our dreams, through our images, through synchronicity in our lives and our complexes. Jung said, the royal road to the unconscious is the complex. The dream speaks about the complex. It tells us where we are in relationship to the complex. And he talked about the psychoid level of the complex, which is the deepest level of the unconscious, which is the deepest level, which is beyond duality. It's beyond form. It's beyond our under us, transcendental. And there's, it's where there is no separation between body, mind, spirit, soul. It's beyond form, and it is the core of the archetype. The core of the archetype is psychoid. It has nothing in it. It's empty. Isn't that interesting? So this is the metaphysical realm. He says, just as in its lower reaches, the psyche loses itself in the organic material substrate, so in its upper reaches, the unconscious resolves itself into a spiritual form about which we know as little as we do about the functional basis of instinct. So on one hand, you have instinct. On the other hand, you have the archetype. And they are really, they work together. But we don't know anything about either one, really. We can hypothesize and talk about them. So how do we feel when we're in relationship to the archetype? We have, people can relate to this, we have strange experiences, we have energy experiences, we have numinous experiences, and numinous means we're fascinated and we're afraid at the same time. If there's that fascination and fear, which Freud had about sexuality, right? It's fascination, sort of whatever else was going on with him, but he was very fascinated with it. And Jung had it more with the archetypal level itself and the self. We have awe, we have fear, we are drawn to it. So we're going to do the Rumi. We're going to see a film about Rumi. Any thoughts at the moment? As he's queuing this up. Rumi, of course, was a Sufi. He's one of the most famous Sufis. There were many Sufis. And Ibn Arabi was one of the earlier Sufis. And when Rumi, Shams was a wild spiritual influence on Rumi. Shams came into his life, and they had a very profound relationship. It wasn't sexual, but it was incredibly spiritual and soulful and connected. And suddenly Shams disappeared. Some feel like he just left. Some feel like his students killed him. And there's all kinds of speculation of why he suddenly disappeared. And Shams, Rumi was devastated. And that's when Rumi began to really spew out his poetry. And in the Sufi tradition, all religions are equal. If you're a Sufi master, you know that no religion is better than the other. It's the mystical tradition of Islam. So, is it up? It's getting there. Ready? Okay, good. So I want you to just feel what you feel. Don't analyze. Just see what happens when you watch this film.
Generated by Rumi, the Mevlevi order. Their distinctive ritual is a circling motion which has caused those Sufis to be called the whirling dervishes. And it comes from Rumi himself, who found himself drawn to circle pillars in his mosque. He would cup his hand and around the pillar and lean back, and found that motion for some, who knows what the symbolism is, maybe planet circling the sun, would just release a torrent of ecstatic poetry. And much of his poetry just came spilling out of him in that motion. Now that took hold, and his followers developed a similar ritual of circling, in their case, their shape rather than a pillar.
The secret turning in us makes the universe turn. Head unaware of feet, and feet head. Neither cares. They keep turning. The secret turning in us makes the universe turn. It's an image of surrender and discipline at the same time. If you've seen it done, you see that. They go, and then they just open, flower out, and they never fall. They're always in total synchrony. They know where they are. They're in concert with the galaxies and the molecules and all these things that go like this. That's what I've always loved about the Sufis. They say that the great world is inside. This world that looks so huge and magnificent is the microcosm. The macrocosm is our inner life. It just reverses science. Or maybe the new science is saying something like that. But the inner world is the giant place. And the world, the outside world that we see, is the language that we use to speak of the inner.
If we look deeply enough, actually, into the heart of science itself, we might discover that what Rumi and other great seers and sages and the wisdom tradition were saying was actually true. At the heart of creation, there is only that field of love, that ultimately even our material success comes from the ability to love and have compassion, comes from the capacity to experience joy and ecstasy and share it with others.
So, just looking, watching the whirling, has anybody seen the whirling dervishes? Aren't they wonderful? I remember sitting on bleachers and I was squirming and my back hurt and everything, and then I just started tuning into them. There was one who was really had his head over here and was just turning, and I just totally relaxed and just went into a lovely space. So when you just witness that, what just without thinking, just kind of going into your own experience and body, what word just comes up? What?
Ease.
Peace?
Mm-hmm. Freedom.
Freedom.
Ease.
Ease.
Mm-hmm. Nature of life.
Nature of life.
Grace.
Mm-hmm.
Organic. Light.
What?
Light.
Light. Mm-hmm. Anybody else?
Yeah.
Continuous.
Continuous. Uh-huh. Yeah.
Dizzy.
That's hard. It's amazing they can do that. Has anybody tried to do that? Yeah? I've done it on authentic movement on several occasions. And it's quite amazing to find that turning point inside myself where I just kept turning around it and I didn't get dizzy. It's amazing. So somebody back here has?
White cotton.
White cotton, okay, good. Yeah, yeah. When he talks about it, what came up for you? When Coleman Barks and Chopra and Houston Smith talk about it, what resonated for you?
That the inner world is a macrocosm.
Mm-hmm.
The inner world is the macrocosm. This is the microcosm. Isn't that amazing? Yeah. The archetypal world, the inner world. Of course, the where everything in nature is infused, as the alchemists knew, with spirit, with soul, and with the scintilla natura, the tiny sparks of light. So the reason I did this thesis is because I was having I've had experiences, and my clients were having experiences, and I wanted to understand what Jung said about this and how to work with it. So my own work, when I first got on the movement floor in authentic movement, as we call it in movement work, it's active imagination in Jungian terms, I felt like I had come home. It was a place where I could fully immerse myself into the body, soul continuum and do whatever I needed to do in a protected place. So there are three times. Yeah.
Yeah, I just had a question. Mm-hmm. Would you say the dervishes were manifesting what you would call the subtle body?
Yes, absolutely.
Can you say a little more?
I will. That's what we're talking about. Okay. Yes. Okay. Thank you. Yeah. So there are three times in our life where we're particularly close to the archetypes. When we're a child, and we were still coming into this world. When we're adolescents, and we're changing and transforming. I had a stepson in Houston who used to go out and talk to the fig tree. And my ex was a Jungian analyst, his mother was a Jungian analyst, and I was a Jungian analyst. And as an adolescent, he wanted to be a Jungian analyst, and I went, uh-oh, he's in real trouble here. And then in old age, has anybody read Maladoma Patrice Somme's autobiography of Water in the Spirit? It's wonderful. He was from Africa. He's a shaman speaker. And I've collected a whole library of modern spiritual autobiographies that I feel like are real, not just sort of out there. And his is one of them. And his father was a very, very important leader in the African tribe, a medicine man. And he was older. And as children, they lived with their grandparents, the children, until they were a certain age. And then they went to their parents and started learning about the other world. And so Maladoma grew up with his grandfather. And his grandfather, he had all these different altered subtle body experiences, and his grandfather was right there with him and actually took him on some of them. And in that culture, the little children live with the elderly, with the elders, because they're both close to the unconscious. And then, of course, in adolescence, they go through a ritual to help them come through into the adulthood. So the first half of life is, of course, coming into the body. The body ego is first with the mother, and developing the sense of I, the ego, which is very important. We have to have that in order to grow, to develop consciousness. It's also the time that we develop our complexes. And our complexes are all of our issues and our relation. At the core of the complex is the archetypal core, the mother, the father, the trickster, the villain, the queen, the king, the fairy. I mean, I'm trying to think of some archetypes. The snake, all of them. Many, many archetypes. And it's a time of separation from the unconscious, and we hope to create, in ideal situations, which never happens, we hope to create an ego that is flexible. It is the organ of the consciousness. It is in its true nature, it is the relationship between the self, the big S self that guides us, and the outer world. It's a mediator in its true nature. So it knows its relationship to the self. It doesn't think it controls things. That's a good thing to get to, right? In many years of therapy and analysis. So we separate from the unconscious, we hopefully create a good ego, and we create the subject. We create the I, the me, as opposed to the mother, the you, the divine, the spiritual place, and we come into the world. So Jung says individuation, which is later, individuation is coming back to the unconscious. It's becoming our true self. Jung says, again and again, I note that the individuation process is confused with the coming of the ego into consciousness. Isn't that interesting? And the ego is, in consequence, identified with the big S self, if that gets confused. Individuation, then, is nothing but ego-centeredness. We keep thinking we're in control, we're it, we're the self. But the self comprises infinitely more than the mere ego, as all symbolism has shown from old. So this creation of the subject is very, very important, because then, once we've created the subject, the I, then we can have a good relationship with the object, either outside of ourselves, the world, other people, or, as Jung was talking about specifically, inside of ourselves, the divine, the archetypal level, the God, whatever guides us from inside. So this creation of the subject is crucial in order to become confronted by the object. And Jung says, no one who strives for selfhood or individuation is spared a dangerous passage, for that which is feared is also belongs to the wholeness of the self. So whenever people come into analysis and they're afraid of something, I go, oh good, we're on the edge, which is where we need to be in order to grow. On that edge, we don't want to fall over the edge unless we have a parachute. But we want to be able to go up to the edge and look down or up or whatever and stay on that edge. So, for that which is feared also belongs to the wholeness of the self. The suprahuman world of the collective unconscious, or he says psychic dominance, from which the ego originally emancipated itself. This liberation is certainly a very necessary and heroic undertaking, but it represents nothing final. It is merely the creation of the subject, who, in order to find fulfillment, has still to be confronted by an object. And of course, the more we're individuated, the more we can have a real relationship with another person and not just project all of our complexes and issues onto them. Please feel free to ask questions or comment. Is this making sense? Mm-hmm. Okay, cool.
So to be confronted by an object refers to one's love interest?
On the outer world, it would be love interest.
What else?
Nature, community, on the outer world. Politics, all the things that we have to be confronted with, an object on the outer world, particularly relationships, right? Very important. But on the inner world, it's about being in relationship to the shadow, to the anima ananas, to different parts of the psyche itself, and to the divine sacred presences, however that manifests. For each person in different religions, they talk about the same thing, really, but with different manifestations, correct? So the archetypal world, in other words, yeah. Okay, so let's see.
Would you say a little more about different religions, about religions and how the parallels, about the parallels with that?
Well, that's a whole lecture in itself, isn't it? Well, let's take the image of the self.
Can you repeat the question? I couldn't hear.
She wants me to compare different religions and how.
Or just give an example.
Yeah. How religions might manifest different. So the self in different religions, in the Sufi tradition, like the dervishes were going around the sheikh, and the sheikh would be sort of the center, the witness, the teacher. And for a dervish or somebody who's studying Sufism, the sheikh would represent to them the self and would be guiding them towards a healthy relationship with the self. In Christianity, Christ would be an image of the self. In Islam, Muhammad would be an image. Buddha, or the Bodhisattvas, Kuan Yin, all those. Let's see. In shamanism, say the world tree, which connects us to all different levels, dimensions of the world. So that's an easy example. Okay. Let's see. So we have to learn that the ego is not in charge, that the self is guiding us, and to trust that process. And that's very hard. It's very hard to trust the process. Jung says, if somebody cannot be alone with themselves, then how can they be with anybody else? And what he meant by being alone with himself was not, I'm going to go play the piano today, or I'm going to read a book, or I'm going to clean my house alone. But what he meant was, can you sit? Can you be comfortable with your unconscious? Can you relate to your unconscious? Can you meditate and bring up issues and work with them? So the complex, as I said, we know we're in a complex when we have an ongoing reaction to somebody or something. That's a red flag. If somebody gets really upset with you and angry, and you have an immediate angry response, which may be very helpful, that's fine. But if you keep mulling it over and you keep going back and trying to figure it out and all that, then you know you're in a complex. And so the complex, again, has an archetypal core, like a mother complex or a father complex, which everybody has. Some of the mother complexes might have the witch, or the good witch or the bad witch, or the Madonna, or and a father complex could have a tyrant, or a dictator, or a very positive, gentle person, father. So, but that archetypal core doesn't have anything in it, and then our relationship to our, as we grow, to our parents and to other people, creates for us, helps us to create a whatever relationship we will have with that archetype. And then, so we have this archetypal core, and around it, remember the old way, they used to talk about atoms, you'd have this core, and then you'd have all these lovely little orbits running around the core. So around this archetypal core, we have concepts and images and symbols and memory and sensation and emotion and energetic experiences and thoughts all circling around, say, the witch complex. I happen to be working with a lot of women who are working on their witch complex, so that's sort of up for me in terms of them. Not me, of course. So,
I saw your broom out front. Yeah. I saw your broom out on the side.
I'll talk to them. Okay, so as we work on the complex, we get deeper and deeper towards that archetypal core. So in some ways, people come into analysis and say, how long is this going to take? And I said, I don't know. Hopefully, unfolding of you and your true self will take the rest of your life. And you'll never stop being open to that. How long you work with me is totally up to you. And what, you know, you may work on a piece of work, go away, come back. As we work on the complex, we weave together this personal material and the archetype. And as people get deeper into their complex, they have to begin to face the archetypal level of it. And that comes up in images like snakes and dinosaurs and nature, trees.
Transpersonal
images, as we were talking about. The devil. I had Hitler in the 80s, and I went, oh no, I have Hitler in my psyche? So it's taken me a little while to come to my positive aspect of the archetypal father. So this object then, is it the outer world or the inner world? And we want to get to a good relationship with the self, our wholeness, and the self, some other images for the self, or the primordial one, the universal being, the Tao. The Tao is a good image. Allah, the friend, the diamond body, the philosopher's stone, that's our true wholeness, the true gold in alchemy. And as we do this, Jung talks about the archetype and seeing into this complex archetypal cord is the window into eternity. The window into eternity. Has anybody seen the beautiful book of Berkhauser's Window into Eternity? He was a wonderful artist. It's gorgeous, isn't it? Wonderful artist in Switzerland. He was a graphic artist, very famous. And he had a profound dream that he drew, which is this his wife, who has this blue aura around her head. And she's being confronted by this very strange mantis creature that's all different colors, multicolors, that's coming to her. And she's fine, and he's cowering in the corner. So his anima, his feminine side, knows how to relate to the transpersonal, the self, in the form of this very strange fish archetypal creature. But he took him, his whole lifetime, he went into analysis with von Franz, and his paintings are just phenomenal about the archetypes. If you have a chance, go. Do you have it in your library? No, it's beautiful. You do? Yeah, Berkhauser. There's a small book, and then there's another book called Window into Eternity that his daughter did after he died, with von Franz's quotes and her work with his images herself. So Jung says, as a result of the integration of the conscious and the unconscious, our ego enters the divine realm, where it participates in God's suffering, And I think he's talking about the answer to Job here. This is in Collected Works 11. But the cause of the suffering is in both cases the same, namely incarnation on a human level, in which the human level appears as individuation. So God's suffering, so as we enter into the divine realm and we have a relationship with the divine, then God changes, the archetype changes. On my first major exam, they said, does the archetype change? It's like, yes, the archetype changes. And on the core, it never changes, but my relationship to it changes, and that's what the answer to Job is about. It was about Job, God realizing that he needed to incarnate in order to understand and transform himself. So, as a result of the integration of the conscious and the unconscious, our ego enters the divine realm, where it participates in God's suffering. The cause of the suffering in the human and the divine is incarnation, which on the human level appears as individuation. So the more individuated we become, the more incarnated we become. Okay. We're gonna queue up the next one. Any questions? Yeah.
The circular motion that was on the previous video, is there any relatedness between that and Jung's theory of psychic growth being linear and then circumambulatory after a while?
Yeah, there would be a relationship between the circumambulation and the dervish's turning.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that kind of signify like wholeness or freedom?
Yeah, they are in a subtle body experience, and they're here and they're not here. Has anybody had an altered state? Yeah. So you know that you're conscious, but you're not here. When I would do authentic movement, I'd go sometimes into subtle body states. And afterwards, or I had a group, and afterwards when people would come out of a subtle body state, I would say, okay, get in your car, breathe, get in your car, make sure you know where the stoplights are and the stop signs, and you have to come back to Earth. You need that transition. So it's very important when people go very deep that we have a strong container, a strong alembic for them, right? Which the witness, the therapist, whoever, whatever we are, the teacher, has, and that we help them move in and out. The whole point is to find that edge and be able to move in and out of it, to move back and forth between realms, between different levels of our unconscious and our psyche. Did you have a question?
Yeah, I was just going to ask, when you mentioned the archetype changing, could you give perhaps an example of symbolically, maybe an archetypal image would shift from one variation to the next?
Yeah, you see it in dreams a lot, in people's images. Let's see. I'm trying to think of an example right now. I've worked with an analyst. She's 85 now, and periodically I still consult with her, and she loves nightmares. You have a nightmare? Oh, good. Because that's where the meat is, in that fear. And what the dream is showing us is what's bad or going to get us. It's showing us what we're afraid of. And Jung said that when you're doing active imagination, or when you're really deeply working with the unconscious, there is no problem except for panic. As long as somebody doesn't panic and get too anxious, then you can stay with the process and you can ride it through. So, say in a nightmare, like my Hitler, okay, my image of Hitler, which is a horrendous, and that was a horrible oppression that I got from my childhood. And as it changed, it became less autocratic, less dictatorial, and it changed images then, and it became corporations, sorry, and then it became spies and different things. And my last dream of that, before it became very helpful and human, was I had a dream. My mother had all the James Bond books when I was a kid, so I read all Ian Fleming's James Bond books. So I was fascinated with James Bond. He was my hero. He could do no wrong. He walked into traps and walked out of them, and it was just amazing. So I realized that he was my positive masculine. He knew how to confront evil, the Hitlers of the world. And my final, so he started coming into my dreams when I started working with him, and my final dream of him was that he had, so it shifted from the Hitler to the helper, and my final dream of him was he put these incredibly beautiful bells around my ankles and he was teaching me to dance. So that's an image of Hitler slowly faded, and I rarely get those kind of dreams except when I'm really in a bad complex. So, does that help?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Could you say some more about the center of the archetype being
yeah. Well, that's a hard thing to talk about because we can't talk about it. As Jung says, we call the unconscious unconscious because it's unconscious. Let's see. Let me mull on that and come back to it, okay, specifically. It doesn't have form. It's not form. It's beyond duality. It's beyond form. So it's sort of like there's a threshold where it comes into form, into the dream, into an energetic experience or an emotional experience or a synchronicity. So that's where the manifestation happens. It comes into form. Does that make sense? Yeah. That's the cycloid. There is no form. It's beyond form. Beyond duality, I think, is the best way to put it. Yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to make sure I got that clear about the archetypal variation. Are you saying that the image that is gleaned off of the archetype or that we interface with will shift as we evolve in our relationship to it,
right?
But the core of the archetype, you know, the inherent ontological aspect does not.
Well, it's not ontological yet until it comes into our psyche, right?
Right. But so, that let's just say the core of the archetype does not vary. The core pattern.
The non-manifest does right. not. Well, we don't know really, but the concept is it does not. It is there. It is not there and there. it is in some other dimension. I don't know. But yes, as it manifests, then our relationship to it and it changes its relationship to us.
as we change our relationship to it.
Yeah, as we work with it.
Right.
Right.
Okay.
Sounds like the concept is borrowed from the Dante.
Sure. I mean, that's where these concepts are not new.
Right.
They're just put it, you don't just put them in modern ideas. Okay. Okay. Now, this is a very different movie. This is from Maya Deren. Does anybody know the movie maker Maya Deren? She was she lived in New York in the 40s and 50s, I think. This, I think, is in the 40s. And she was a voodoo initiate. And she went to Haiti because she wanted to experience voodoo. But Haiti has the purest voodoo in the world. It's an African religion. And does anybody know Maya Deren? This is a movie called The Divine Horseman, and it's about the voodoo religion in Haiti. And they let her, they trusted her enough to let her film their rituals, and it's a beautiful film. And this is about a priest going into trance. And I love showing this film because it's so out of our cultural context. It really helps us to get a feeling of this subtle body experience. And the Loa are the gods. And the Hungung are the priests, and they're men and women Hungung. And this is a male Hungung, and you can tell he's a priest because he has a gourd. And everybody can go into trance. It's not limited to priests. The reason, and priests are actually the most powerful force in Haiti, way more powerful than the government. So this is a voodoo priest going into trance. And the god that they're working with right now is called Legba, and he's the god of the threshold, which in all their rituals they work with him first, because you have to have the threshold to be able to work with the other gods. So I want you to just, again, relax and let the images and the rhythms and the music come in and see what you feel.
Possession is the psychic phenomenon which occurs when a divinity becomes manifest. In the terminology of voodoo, it is said that the Loa mounts a person, or that a person is mounted by the Loa. The metaphor is drawn from a horse and his rider, and the actions and events which result are the expression of the will of the rider. It is the center towards which all roads of voodoo converge. It is the point which one travels by the most visible and physical means. Yet to the traveler, it is itself invisible.
Kundalini.
Uh-huh. Yeah, same idea, right? Uh-huh.
Unconscious.
Primitive.
Supple.
Body.
Mm-hmm.
Energetic.
Surrender.
Mm-hmm.
Primeval.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else?
Killing chickens.
Not what we do anymore. The sacrifice. What else? Somebody said something over here?
Water.
Okay. So why do we want to do this? What's he trying to connect with? All the dancers are trying to connect with it. He just happened to be the one who got ridden by the Loa. Isn't that interesting? The god rides us.
Real?
The most real? Yeah. Uh-huh.
The invisible world.
Yeah. Why? Why do you want to do this? Why would you want to do that?
To learn what else there is.
What other dimensions there are, what the source of life.
Search for meaning.
Mm-hmm. I was so struck by his eyes.
Yes.
Watch what's he seeing.
Uh-huh.
Nothing in this world.
Yeah. But go ahead. Back.
No, I was just remembered reading that shamans from other tribes would do that to find out what was the healing that was needed for, you know, a particular individual or family or the tribe. They would do it with an intention and a focus.
Right, so bring back
wisdom,
understanding, healing, information from a deeper source, mm-hmm. which was what our dreams are trying to do for us. Right. Somebody was just reminding me of something. It'll come around again. So this is what we want to do. The eyes, yes. Very, but he was definitely not here visually, was he? But did he trip and fall over himself and run into everybody else? No. He knew, somehow his body knew sort of where he was in space. He leaned back and people supported him. But he allowed that to happen. He didn't just fall over. And he's obviously, these people are, they know how to go over this threshold and move into trance and come back. We don't know how to do that. And we get into trouble around that threshold. So isn't that interesting that he could be that far out and still somewhat present? Which is what you learn as you work with this material and energy, particularly in the body. It has to be grounded in the body, and the rhythm is part of the container for what's going on, and the circle. And you saw some of the drawings on the, there was a pole in the middle, and the priest, one of the head priests, does a beautiful chalk mandala around the center to start to create the space for the ritual. So,
okay.
Yeah.
So if we don't know how to work with the threshold, what do we need to have? What do we need to develop to be able to?
Yeah, that's why you're here. That's why I'm here.
What was the name of the snake again?
The snake got, he said Jambala. And Jambala, the snake actually is the earliest symbol of the goddess in most traditions. Which is interesting. It's the feminine. So, and that which is often the root of all of it. I've done a lecture on called the sacred feminine erotic soul, which is tracing that from the goddess to modern times. So, okay. So Jung says the physiological unconscious. The so-called somatic unconscious, which is the subtle body, becomes material because the body is the living unit and our conscious and unconscious are embedded in it. So that's where it manifests.
The unconscious, the somatic unconscious comes into our body. And so what kinds of experiences did you see from the dervishes and from this that people experience when you get into a transcendent subtle body level of work?
Cathartic. Completely unself-conscious.
Completely at one with the primordial or the instinct or wherever the energy takes us.
You don't care what it looks like or what people approve of what you're doing.
Exactly. Yeah. You're just there.
Yeah.
No ego.
What?
No ego.
Well, ego enough to know where you are in space, right? But the ego steps aside and says, come. Which is one thing we have to learn, how to step aside.
Being danced more than dancing,
yeah. That we don't have to be in charge, which is very difficult for us modern people, isn't it? If Trump is somewhere out there, he thinks he's in charge. Talk about, caught a little cord there, didn't I? This will be an interesting election, isn't it? We really have gotten about as polarized as we can get, haven't we? But as Jung said, democracy is the only hope because the shadow and the polarities of the unconscious can be manifested and seen and dealt with. Yes. So that's my hope.
I have a question, or half-formed thought, just about embodied experiences and just the way that we talk about them in the mm-hmm. world, like whether we're talking about it right now.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's actually been one of my big struggles.
Sure,
with
absolutely.
Jung land is that Jung embraces everything, including the body, and yet we tend to talk about it in this very, very heady way and
exactly.
talk about this very heady space. And I've done it for myself, like my inferior function by far is sensing. So in a lot of ways, I think, I feel like Jung is saying, actually, don't be here.
In some ways,
don't be here, be in a yoga class, be in, you know, things that are more physical, things that would, you know, that doing the embodied experience.
Well, we certainly need
yeah.
more body stuff in modern life, don't we? Yeah. And yoga, there are many, many forms we can work with. Many forms of yoga, dervishes, Sufi, you know, whatever. But that's hard to talk about. Have people gone into subtle body experiences and then you try to talk to a friend or your therapist about them and it's like, I don't know how to talk about this. It's hard. I think part of it is our English language. If we had studied Sanskrit, we would probably have more words to describe our experiences. But I think we also just don't know how, and I think the culture doesn't know how to listen either. You know, people look at you and go, really? You had what? What are you talking about? So it's hard. Does that sort of help?
Well, is it important to put it into words?
Well, that's a good point. When we're having an experience, is it important? Not particularly. But it is important, even if you look at the mystical traditions, if you look at Teresa of Avila, for example, who went into very deep trances. That wonderful statue of her that's totally entranced. Remember that wonderful statue of her? I forget who did it.
The angel. Oh.
The angel?
Bernini.
Right. She's just totally in a state of ecstasy. And her confessor said, you have to write this down. And that's when the seven
interior
castle. Thank you. She wrote, but the only way she could write about it was in symbolic form. She couldn't say this happened and this happened and this happened. She had to try to explain it through archetypal language, right? So I'm up here trying to explain it in sort of everyday language. And you're right, it's very difficult, partly because of the material itself. And that's something we work on in an active imagination group or an authentic movement group of being able to sit with somebody, and we'll work with this tomorrow, being able to sit with somebody and allow the experience to speak for itself and allow the symbol to emerge. And the symbol will speak sometimes more than our explanations of it. And yeah, we try to talk about everything in a heady way, don't we?
we should probably all just get up and move and forget about talking to them. Okay, so this is an example that Jung tried to put into words. So when he first descended into the unconscious, he met an anima figure called Salome, and he was terrified of her. And he worked with Salome for many years. And then then he had this experience with her, and he talks about it in the Red Book differently than he talks about it in the 1925 seminar, which is very interesting. So this is what he says in the 1925 seminar, which is a little different than the Red Book. I'll tell you what it is. He says, so he meets Salome, and he says, then a most disagreeable thing happened. Salome became very interested in me, and she assumed that I could cure her blindness. She began to worship me. I said, why do you worship me? She replied, you are Christ. In spite of my objections, she maintained this. I said, this is madness, and became filled with skeptical resistance. Then I saw the snake. She always travels with the snake. I saw the snake approach me. The snake came close and began to encircle me and press me in her coils. The coils reached up to my heart. I realized as I struggled that I had assumed the attitude of the crucifixion. He did this without realizing it. In the agony and the struggle, I sweated so profusely that the water flowed down on all sides of me. Then Salome rose, and she could see. Okay. While the snake was pressing me, I felt that my face had taken on the face of an animal or prey, a lion or a tiger. Now in the Red Book, he says that he sweated blood, but he softened it a little bit in the 1925 lectures. So this was a very embodied experience Jung had. If you read the Red Book, it's full of Jung saying, having all kinds of emotional reactions and physical reactions to his encounters in the unconscious. So you see, he was really a very earthy guy with all of his amazing intellect, his brilliance and genius. But when you hear this story of him trying to explain what happened to him, what comes up for you?
Well, boy, oh boy, he was either wildly inflated or or the self was coming through.
Uh-huh. You know,
and this bodily sweating blood, the blood of Christ, and mm-hmm. this was an image of her then, the blindness. But it does seem to walk a wild kind of type.
Absolutely.
There, you know?
The Red Book, I mean, all of these experiences do.
Yeah.
Right? And that's why I work a lot with trauma. And what I discover in trauma is the archetypal core, of course, is usually very negative in the complex. And as people work on it, if they can go deeply, they have to go and face that witch. They have to face the demon. They have to face the devil. They have to face whatever it is. And it's very scary, and it takes people to very strange emotional and energetic places.
Well, and what you were saying earlier about if it's just ego and it's not really embedded in the self,
right,
then it's just more ego and more inflation.
Mm-hmm.
That's what you spoke about earlier.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. And von Franz, and Jung says this too, that in the process of our individuation process, when we connect with the self, we do get inflated.
Yeah.
It's a natural thing that happens. The question is, can we recognize it and deal with it? And go, oh, okay, well, that was nice. And then often after an inflation, we get deflated. When you have a deep spiritual experience, you come back to everyday life and you go, oh, well, this isn't fun. That was natural fun. I had a car accident after a period of time when I was very sort of in an inflated time. When I was just sort of floating in the spirit, and the car accident brought me right back, you know? but that's something we have to really learn how to handle and deal with, and I think that's what the witness can help us. And staying, and if we get too inflated, we'll just get hit over the head, right? And we'll get pulled back down anyway.
Yeah.
Because that's the whole balancing, that's the whole moving between the opposites. The personal and the collective.
Having an association as you're talking, I went to the Pacifica conference on climates of change and therapy by ideas, which is fabulous.
Climate change?
Pacifica. Climates of change in the therapy of ideas.
Mm-hmm.
I went to a pre-conference and it was on Dionysus.
Mm-hmm.
And they were talking about, you know, the kind of what's involved in the Dionysian world or archetype. I don't even know where I'm going with this, but you had mentioned
it's hard to know where you're going with this stuff sometimes.
You had mentioned a car accident, and it was funny because Dionysus is about bringing us into the present moment in whatever way is necessary.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, one of the presenters of the workshop had a car accident right before the talk because she was thinking about the talk.
That's a lot of these archetypes.
But it's like the immediate, I guess, Dionysian. We live in
Apollonian. Mm-hmm. We live in Apollonian.
And it has its place, but it's become the thing. And so they were talking about, you know, the qualities of Dionysus, and Dionysus is coming back, but Dionysus is about the immediacy of the moment.
And
other things.
Right, the immediacy of the moment, the body, the
right.
Ecstasy, the wine, the letting go.
Being torn apart, sacrifice.
But he's also about love and expansion and creativity and the soul and the spirit. And so all archetypes have positive and negative aspects. So our culture and our upbringing puts us in relationship to the positive or the negative aspect of it. And we don't, in our culture, we're more Apollonian, and we don't know how to be Dionysian in a healthy way. So we get drunk because we crave that. We crave the Dionysian. Or we do drugs. Or whatever. We jump out of airplanes or climb mountains and get lost or whatever we need to do. But we need that. We need both. And I do I've taught the Dionysian Pompeiville of Mysteries. The women's mysteries, and at the woman goes through the different stages to get to the initiation chamber where Dionysus and Ariadne are. Mm-hmm. And Dionysus is sitting on Ariadne's lap. She's holding him sort of like the Pietà in a way. And actually it was the only fresco in Pompeii of the entire mysteries that got a little damaged by the volcano. So you can't see Dionysus and Ariadne's face. You can only see their bodies, which I think is very interesting. But so he's being held by the feminine in on that level. So it's very interesting. Yeah. And that's one of the reasons why we need this kind of information and this kind of work, because we need to get back in balance. As Jung said, we're out of balance in the modern world. So
I actually had a quick question on that. A lot of Jung's books, he refers to that reminds me of like a Promethean debt.
The what? Promethean?
Promethean debt.
Debt.
What does that mean?
Some
of his books, he says because of the imbalance and the deviation.
Well, like Prometheus stole the fire from the gods, so he meant that we have to be
guilt.
Yeah, our guilt for doing that. Fire is very important. But we carry a burden when we go to and steal fire from the gods, right? We have to then learn how to work with the fire. Okay. So, an example. Let me give you an example. This is a woman that I worked with in Houston. She was a very devout Christian, beautiful devout Christian. I went from the Bible Belt in Houston, working with people with the Bible Belt. I didn't grow up there. For 25 years, and then I went back to the Northeast and went back to the Buddha Belt. So in the Bible Belt, everybody's turning your other cheek, do unto you, your neighbors what you would do unto yourself. In the Buddha Belt, everybody's have compassion. But so we have to face the shadow.
right? So that she had this very deep heart connection with Christ, which really, and she was psychic, and she had deep trauma, but it was very interesting to work with her because she really didn't need to work with her trauma. She had been always connected with nature, with the archetypal positive energy in nature, and had driven her bicycle and wandered around in nature to get away from the abuse. And I kept sort of trying to take her back to her childhood. It wasn't like that she was like, no, I want to go there. It's like, whatever, you know. And she had many interactions with archetypal phenomena and Christ helping her and things. And so we did a lot of active imagination. And she told me about this experience. She was standing on her porch one day in the middle of suburbia Houston, Republican land. And she was standing on the porch waiting for the rain to stop so some furniture could be delivered. This is a lovely little example. And so she says, I gave up hoping and decided to pray about it. I began to talk to God in the middle of the suburbs of Houston. I apologize that this was a vain and insignificant matter. I asked God to please stop the rain long enough for my furniture to be unloaded without getting wet. The answer that I heard was, tell it to the rain. Needless to say, I was stunned. I didn't expect to hear back from God, and was totally confused over the message that I had received. I asked, how do you talk to the rain? Then I saw a vision of people dancing around in a circle in my front lawn. I heard a voice say, like we've always done. And I felt the spirit of these people and the meaning of the dance. It was sacred. It was talking to the rain. I stepped out into the rain in the middle of Houston. I began to dance around with the circle with the people in the vision. I told the rain everything through her movement. I felt the rain welcome me and acknowledge me. My spirit soared. I felt like I was dancing with old friends. I could see them so clearly, and I felt as if I was dancing with them. I knew this time was special, and I didn't want it to stop. It only lasted a few minutes, and it was over as simply as it had started. I stopped, the rain stopped, and the furniture truck came around the corner. A request that I felt had started out so vainly and insignificantly had been turned into a song of beauty that called Spirit to Dance. What more can I say? It was fantastic. So, these are the kinds of experiences. I mean, that's a lovely one. It's not scary at all. She was very comfortable with this realm. Actually, the work that we did was to finding, she could hold a baby and know if it was sick. It was going to die, and she said, I don't want to know this. Why do I have to know this? And it was always true, whatever she felt. And so really our work was for her to be comfortable with that part of herself, with her connection to the self. Okay. So the question is, what do we do? How do we do this? How do we approach it? What do we... Well, so Jung tried to put this in modern terminology. Jung tried to talk about it. He had many experiences as a child that we can read in Memories, Dreams, Reflections. And he discovered this in the Red Book. Again, it's not new information. It's been around for thousands, millions of years, ever since we've been around. And it's about active imagination. In dreams, we have passive imagination, where the dream comes to us in a passive state. And an active imagination, how many people do active imagination? I know that, yeah. In active imagination, we have a conscious dialogue in consciousness with the unconscious. And this is where the subject and the inner object connect through active imagination. And it has to be experiential. It can't just be in our head. We can't just conceptualize about it and talk about it from our brain. The Sufis called this the mundus imaginalis, the world of the imagination. The mundus imaginalis. And it's an intermediate realm between this realm and the archetypal realm where we meet, and we're in subtle body when we meet there. Jung said, the place or medium of realization is neither mind nor matter, but the intermediate realm of subtle reality, which can be adequately only expressed by the symbol. So it comes out in symbols. The symbol is neither abstract nor concrete, neither rational nor irrational, neither real nor unreal. But we know it has power. It moves us. It changes us. It calls to us. It tells us, it puts us in relationship to something bigger. It puts us in proper relationship to our true nature and the self. So he says, it is in the creative fantasies that we find the unifying function we seek. In the creative fantasies. All the functions that are active in the psyche converge in fantasy. Fantasy has its own irreducible value, for it is a psychic function that has its roots in the conscious and the unconscious, in the individual and the collective. If it is understood as a healing, as an authentic symbol, it acts as a signpost, providing the clues we need in order to carry our lives in harmony with ourselves. So when we engage in active imagination, the symbol comes in and it guides us. It tells us where we are, where we need to go, how we need to relate. So it's in the creative fantasy. I think this is very important and where Jung really differs from other people. It's that Don Kelsha talks this about this a lot. He's really brought it back into the world in terms of working with it a lot, and the Red Book too. I remember when I went to the Red Book opening in New York, Sean Dasani, we were in this huge auditorium, a lot of people, and he was going to introduce the Red Book to us. We'd never seen it. Well, it was at the museum, but so we're all sitting there, and he says a few words, and then he just starts a slideshow of each page turning. And every once in a while, he would just read a sentence from the Red Book, and that's all he did. And a friend of mine who was a Jungian analyst came up to me and said, Erica, he didn't tell us anything. What are people going to think? And I said, well, that's the point. He didn't tell us anything. He didn't lecture us. He allowed us to journey into it a tiny bit. And of course, Jung wrote about his stuff, and then later he did all the paintings of it, which are absolutely amazing, the paintings. So these are the tools. We have the symbol, which can come in any form, can it? I mean, Jung talks about image, but by image, he doesn't just mean visual. Actually, when I did my work on active imagination and I really read Jung on active imagination, I realized, and I had my ex-husband had just come back from Zurich, he trained in Zurich, and I asked him, because I kept reading other stuff after Jung, that kept saying, well, you have to sit down and write the fantasy, or you have to draw it or something, but that's it. And I went, what? Because Jung talks about the image as being all different kinds of experiences. It can come up in clay, it can come up in movement, it can come up in music. If Beethoven wasn't tuned into something, I don't know who was. All the great composers, I just saw the movie Miles Davis, Miles Ahead. Has anybody seen that movie? Which is not a good representation of Miles Davis, according to a friend of mine who knew is a jazz musician. But Miles Davis was brilliant. He totally changed the jazz world because he was totally tuned into something else. And he brought improvisation into jazz for the first time to that level that he did. So it can happen in any form. And the symbol is a living thing. It's a felt. There's a wonderful book by one of the early analysts, Adler, called The Living Symbol. And if it doesn't touch us, if it doesn't resonate with us, it's not our symbol. So I can walk into
I love churches. I love churches. But the cross doesn't do anything to me. Just the building and the feeling in the church itself does something to me. But somebody else might see the cross and have a very deep connection to it. So the symbol is a conductor. It conducts this archetypal core energy into manifestation so we can dialogue with it. It protects us. It protects us from just the raw energy of the archetype. It gives us something it mediates the energy and the emotional aspect of the archetype. The symbol is the most primitive exponent and the highest intuition of the unconscious mind. It's the most primitive and the highest intuition. It brings those two pieces together. Let me give you another example. Okay. This is a man. I've worked with Jenna Vedler in California, and there were always 18 of us. And some of us would witness and some of us would move. And this was a man, he was a lawyer, and he mediated in environmental stuff with the state. And he really took his experience of coming to his true nature and being able to sit with anything into his mediation and his ability to witness and just be present. And so he says, this was an experience. As I enter the movement, I think of the importance to me of knowing what's happening and where things are going. Don't you all want to do that? What would it be like to live on the edge of the unexpected? As I lie on the floor, I feel the need to stretch different parts of my body. So he's just following the body. I extend and spread my legs, extend my torso to feel more space between my ribs and reach my arms out as far as possible. I feel my body lengthen and open. It feels delicious. I roll and stretch and extend. I love this spacious feeling. I don't want to become entangled with other movers. As I move, I feel my body rising up from the floor to my knees. I reach to the sky. He's just following what he feels like doing. My body rises again to its feet, like I've been picked up by a gentle, powerful, invisible force. I stand tall, my arms reach back, my head tilts back, and a deep, screechy, mournful howl rises from me and out of me into the fullness of the room and the sky. It comes repeatedly in contrast with other more harmonious sounds in the room. The howl has its own power. This is the symbol for him, this whole experience. It calls to the moon like the coyote in the night has called for thousands of years. It continues through the coyote and through me. I feel magnificent. Something has released in me. I welcome the unexpected. I move into harmony of contact with others. No struggle, no resistance. And his reflections later are, my mind and my body are often constricted. We can relate to this. By my need to control circumstances and be on top of things. The movement, especially the stretching and the howls, come unexpectedly and it's a surprise. That's when we know we're in connection with the living symbol, when we're surprised. It's like, whoa, what did I just do? Who said that? What image is that? It just sort of pops up. That's the edge that we need to learn to open to let the unexpected come in. Okay, the movement, especially stretching in the howls, come unexpectedly and are a surprise. It reminds me of my need to let go and listen for or await some deeper wisdom that comes through me from unknown places in my body. There's so much freedom and relief in the unexpected howl. So that's the liberation he feels in the symbol. When I allow myself to be open to the unexpected and to experience it fully, it brings freedom and release. It allows me to live more in the moment. This movement experience has come repeatedly to me on movement floor. It is also recollected in my daily life. This is where we bring it back. And reminds me to let go howl in whatever I'm doing and reap the riches of the unexpected. So each time we encounter a living symbol, we trust more. We trust that we will find a connection. We trust that we will be guided. We trust that the process will continue whether we're trying to make it happen or not. And I find that it allows me to be more at ease and grounded in my life. Does anybody have any reactions to that experience? You want to move, I know. Let's just get up and stretch for a minute. Yeah. I'm not sitting and talking. It's hard to talk about movement. Just shake out a little bit. Let's just take a big breath. Okay. All right, let's sit down here. So the symbol helps to mediate this energy and the emotional.
How are you?
And coming back to the archetype, Jung says, an image or word picture is of little consequence if it doesn't carry an electrical charge. One cannot speak of an archetype or archetypal experience unless image and emotions coincide. It is a great mistake in practice to treat an archetype as if it were a mere name or a concept. It is far more than that. It is a piece of life, an image connected with the living individual by the bridge of emotion. So if we don't have emotion, we aren't connected. And by the way, dissociation to me is an emotion. It's an experience. It's an experiential place. I work a lot with people who have had trauma and dissociate. And so instead of trying to get them back, I say, take me there. Take yourself there, because you don't even know where you are. Try to help me enter into the space you're in that is not here, so that we can explore it and get to know it and see what's there. And when they feel safe in a place, like the bed is often the safest place to be. And so I say, well, that's okay. As long as you can accept that your bed is the safest place to be and make it that way, you have a place to go. And when you feel safe, then you can come out and you can explore more. So the bed becomes a powerful symbol of safety. So the other piece that's very important is the witness, which, of course, the therapist or the analyst or the teacher is the witness. And so we have the symbol and then our ability to open to it. And the witness, which is the inner witness and the outer witness, we usually have to have an outer witness for a period of time to develop the capacity to be with whatever is. I mean, when you think about spiritual traditions, but the teacher, modern teachers in particular, are much better at speaking about this. What they're trying to do is get you to be able to be with whatever is, whether it's wonderfully positive or scary and deep or nothingness or fear, but whatever it is, and that's what I'm trying to help every client do, is to just be with whatever it is and let it move through you. And the emotion is sort of like a lubricant. It helps something move through us so we can get to the next place. So the witness is the container, the support. It's not about interpreting, okay? We can interpret all we want, and that often gets in the way. I know that I'm in a complex if I start interpreting too much and not just staying with somebody's experience. And so the witnessing comes from a place in each one of us where we can just be with ourselves, not really with that person. Witnessing means to know, these are the roots of it, to know in a deep way, inner knowing, native intelligence, and to make pregnant. That's a beautiful image of it. To make pregnant. So my just being there present with somebody and holding the space and witnessing and then having them tell me, share what happened, is making to help make pregnant what's coming up, what can be birthed. And there are three steps that are very important. One is to just allow it to happen, whether you're drawing, throwing a pot, sculpting, weaving, moving. And moving is, I think, the hardest thing for us to talk about, which is why I like to talk about this. And so it comes to every all senses. I'm not a sensation. Were you calling that sensation? Yeah. I'm not a, that's my inferior function. And I did authentic movements in 75, and then I worked with Janet for 5 years, and I didn't see her for a while. And the next time I saw her, I was really stuck in my movement work. I would take dream images, and I would move to the image. And that wasn't working anymore, and I thought, oh, maybe I'm done with this, I don't know. But I was beginning to have very strange experiences, and she came, and she led a group. And as soon as I was in her presence as a witness, I felt very, something in me felt very safe. And I totally opened up to a sensate level of experience. And the inferior function takes us most quickly and deeply into the unconscious. So my sensations would just tell me exactly what direction I needed to be in, what rhythm I needed to be in, what gesture I needed to do. And from that, I would come to an understanding. The beauty of active imagination is we don't have to explain it. We can, like particularly with movement, as with anything, but if we sit with it, say somebody in a movement group might have a particular gesture that keeps coming back and back and back. And I just keep going, okay. And I don't try to analyze it. I don't try to name it. And if I can just be with them and they keep the gesture keeps coming up for them, then at some point they go, oh, and they understand on an emotional level what that gesture has to do with, and suddenly it becomes clear. So I'm not trying to push them to understand it, I'm just trying to hold the space for them. So after the image comes up, then we come back to the witness, which could be ourselves, and we try to put it in some form of... Jung said he didn't quite trust movement, I think. Tina Keller was the first Jungian who did movement with von Franz. She was in analysis with Jung, and I think he went to Africa or somewhere, and so she started working... No, not von Franz. Who did she work? Tony Wolf. Tony Wolf, thank you. And Tony Wolf is much better at just sitting with her. So one day she said, I can't figure this out. Maybe I need to move it. And Tony Wolf said, okay. So she got up and she found herself feeling very stuck. And she just stayed with that and struggled with being stuck. And she had this image of being stuck in a rock, you know. And finally she moved out of the rock and was able to come out and realize, and then the rock is a symbol that then she talked about and shared and pondered and meditated on and realized what that restriction, what that rigidity in herself and where it had come from, and she worked through it. So we want to share, we want to explore. One of the things I'd say, I don't say, don't think about it, I say, well, ponder it, play with it, be curious about it. Sit with it, see what comes up. And then through that comes an integration of whatever it is. And then, as somebody mentioned, we need to bring it. We need to bring the wisdom to our community, to our friends, to our whatever we're doing. And live with it, take the responsibility of living that way. So, okay. So let's have the final DVD. Any questions or thoughts as we're... Yeah?
So what is that idea of witnessing the truth about the brain? Is that from you?
No, that's actually a derivative root from either Latin or German.
Oh, cool.
Yeah. I love etymology. Great. Okay, any other thoughts or questions? Yeah.
Okay. This is kind of a hypothetical thing, but say there is a traumatic experience in an individual, and that traumatic experience is then archetyped. could hypothetically that archetype manifest itself in an anthropomorphic way, in such a way that it could even be an imaginary friend?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Could that first occur in maybe a dream? And like even in not adolescence but adulthood, could that happen?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
The archetype comes up as both the persecutor, as Donald Kalsha says so beautifully, or the and the protector, and also the guide. So when we have to face a very negative archetype like Hitler or the witch or something, then the opposite aspect of the archetype will eventually manifest, because we can't change, we can interact, but we don't have power over the devil or the demon or the horrible whatever it is, the witch, and we need help. So as we work with it, eventually the positive side of the archetype, an angel or a teacher or Philemon for Jung, that was Philemon's guide, will emerge eventually if we can stay with the process, and will balance these energies and archetypes. Does that help?
Yeah.
So that's what I also what I want to help get to is okay, what in your psyche can help with this? How do you feel safe? How do you go in and out of the work, the process, and not go and be just miserable and have accidents and stuff? And how do you and where's the help in your psyche? Okay, so we're coming to we're coming to the modern world right now, and this is Janet Adler doing authentic movement. So, and actually, so just again, just see what comes up for you as we watch this.
Is she related to Alfred Adler?
I don't know, actually. Maybe. I'm not sure. So you want to fast forward just a little bit.
Find this way of work useful as therapy, as resource for any creative process, and as spiritual practice. Though both men and women study this form, in this situation, these eight women are joining me. Authentic movement offers a way of learning how to see and how to be seen as we are. Within this framework, this form assumes complete trust in the body's capacity to remember and to tell the truth. With this dynamic at the center, in the past 20 years, a developmental process has become apparent. First, a person learns to allow self-directed movement in the presence of a witness. Next, the mover learns to witness another person move. Finally, people move and witness in a circle. Moving and witnessing takes us into and through personality, toward an integration of body and spirit, toward wholeness. Now, we begin. As I witness many people moving, I try to create a clear and safe container for the movers, though they take responsibility for their own physical safety by opening their eyes when necessary. Eyes are closed to invite deeper listening. In the dark and silence, journeys begin with feelings, images, sounds, memories, thoughts, and sensations. Gates to the unconscious open as movers descend. As the witness, I have no directions for the movers. There is no way I can know what they must do. Not knowing what to do, Margaret's only guidance comes from her body and its deepening impulses. In the beginning of this process, impulse finds form primarily in three ways. For Margaret, energy is expressed in specific body parts. Elizabeth uses gesture. She is gathering. For Jean, idiosyncratic movements emerge. Originating in the unconscious, they have been buried under the rational, ordered body ego. They may initially appear as irrational and unfamiliar, yet they feel right. As the work develops, personality differences become visible. Some people, like Susan, follow emotions easily. Others, like Margaret, often follow images. Bonnie usually follows her kinesthetic sensations. Patterns emerge. They are expressions of unresolved aspects of personal development. For example, Bonnie finds herself upside down over and over again. Another example, when Susan feels emotional, she often brings her hands to her neck. King's pattern. She moves most truthfully when her head is covered. After moving, we gather in a circle. Movers speak first. What had once been unconscious becomes conscious as people explore, sort through, and try to describe where they've been. As the witness offers her experience in response, each mover can learn that she has been seen. As people see themselves a little more clearly, personal consciousness evolves out of the collective unconscious.
I've gone through a lot of training like this. Just, I'm an actor, and I do a lot of this kind of training.
Mm-hmm.
And it was really interesting to see. Not necessarily in such formality, but there is an acting theory, kind of a concept called the viewpoints.
Mm-hmm.
And it's where you do almost something like that. I mean, kinesthetic awareness is more part of it, and adapting to your cohort in relation to either speed, tempo, shape, and form, and you know, the architect of where you're doing it. But I found a really interesting dualistic quality in how that relates in a psychological phenomena, and also as a tool for a performer,
mm-hmm.
what it can do.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I mean, the nonverbal is on most of our communication.
Mm-hmm.
The verbal is very on the surface, really. And if you, I mean, we all tune in to whether we believe somebody, whether they're telling the truth, you know, all these kinds of things. And we're picking up on nonverbal cues all the time. Rhythm, sensation, energy. You know? So it's an important part of any, I think it's an important part of any training. So, sure, go ahead.
Yeah, I was impressed by the process in terms of how they were able to drop their sensor and get into touch with that. But the whole process reminds me a lot in a much more subdued way to holotropic breath work,
mm-hmm.
where you have a kind of same touch and process and witnessing and the sitter,
yeah.
and then coming out and then processing at the end in terms of all that. But without any of that, really letting go, they could just drop in to that open
air. Right. They trusted.
Yeah.
They trusted the unconscious. They wanted to explore.
Yeah.
I felt like a lot of movements were movements of what we do as children when we have an experience, overwhelming experience, to sort of try to process many major traumas, and that they were recreating those from their own childhood.
Yeah, which is what we're trying to get to. We're trying to get into the complexes which are in the body. If somebody's had been hit, that a gesture like this might come over and over and over again, and they might be dissociated from trauma, and suddenly when they get up home, I'm protecting themselves. So this, to me, this is very important in any psychological work, that we know that the body is the root, the body is where we need to find it. But we're sort of analyzing. Let's just, what do people feel when they saw this? It's easy, it's interesting, because it's sort of easier to watch the Haitian one or the Rumi one. They're not quite as personal in some ways. It's not sort of in your face. So what were people's responses?
Compassion.
Sadness.
Okay.
This seemed a little bit more natural in a way than the other two.
Oh, okay.
It sort of reminded me a little bit of the movements you might make when you're sleeping and dreaming, if you're observing someone there, whereas the other videos seemed a little bit more performative.
Yeah, I don't think they were, but they were more structured.
Yeah.
Sometimes, yeah. But other ones were more structured. Okay. Other responses.
I think it's uncomfortable to just drop in on such a sacred experience.
Right.
Because when you're in space and it's contained, you're part of that container. But the word unknown is really tricky.
Yeah. These are women who are obviously comfortable enough with the process. To be able to be filmed and go, okay. I knew these women would help. So.
Courageous.
Courageous, yes.
A sense of timelessness.
I just got like a sense of grief.
Sense of grief?
Because I think, try not to analyze it, but the feeling of this aspect or this process being really marginalized.
Okay.
And then when the tenemos or whatever, then that phase, that liminal phase or whatever, where you're going from consensus thinking and reality into the deeper embodied, deeper place, I felt an intermediary like grieving. Like that there was something that like that was part of the process.
Okay.
For me, it was my inner sense of it was that.
Maybe your experience.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Just
yeah,
just one word.
Extrovert.
Extrovert. Okay, yeah.
Vulnerability.
Yeah. Early. Anybody else?
Touch.
Touch,
the way that she brushed her eyes with it.
Yeah. And it's interesting what draws us, you know, what particular image from home. Any other?
Wonder.
So, what?
Wonder.
So these women, people who, we don't have to go into authentic movement group to have these experiences. We can just, I have authentic movement groups, but I also just, somebody's sitting, talking to me, and I'm just going, okay, are you in your body?
Mm-hmm.
You know, just tell me what's happening as you're talking about this. Because we want to bring the body and the mind together. So I don't need people to move anymore, because I'm very good at helping them to become embodied in what they're saying in the moment, and working with it. So, and my movement gets subtler and subtler and slower. In fact, I moved with a healer that I'm working with, and so there was all this incredible energy in my body, and I came out of it and just said, wow, that was amazing. You hardly moved at all.
experiences I had with Janet out in California was I had walking pneumonia the other time. I was sick for a long time, and I went to an authentic movement retreat, and she said, should you be here? And I said, this is exactly where I should be. And I lay down on the floor for 5 days in the middle of the room with people with their eyes closed. Nobody touched me. I had the feeling of being in a burrow under the ground, and it was incredibly healing. I went into very deep healing sleep, and I just let go and let my body heal.
You say for 5 days?
5 days.
You're just laying on the ground?
Just laying on the ground. But the image was I was under the ground.
Right.
Curled up in a
fetal embryo.
Yeah. Well, I mean, just like an animal, sort of an amphibian. So, any other thoughts or questions?
Self-connection.
Self-connection. That's what we want, isn't it? That's bigger self and lower self. Liberation. Liberation. We need Congress to get up and do this. Fight it out and face each other. And really, I love watching British Parliament. You know, actually, the last Sanders and Clinton debate, because they were really going at it. I was like, yeah, go at it. So, any other thoughts or questions? Yeah.
Yeah. Well, one witness, eight. People in the center as differentiated from the patient group where one figure was central and the group was on the outer circle of that one. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, well, if you just happen to be capturing the thing, but there are other times that you can see in the movie where everybody stands. Everybody's moving together. People were moving, they just sort of weren't the focus.
The moving together, the timelessness that you said, right? Mm-hmm. And just in a group, the collective, that each person is in their own individual process with eyes closed, and yet I've frequently had the experience as witnessing a group of people like coming up, rising up off the floor at the exact same time. Or it looks like a piece of choreography.
Right.
And they don't consciously know that they're in sync with the person right next to them, but something happens. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And that's part of the power of community.
Relationship happens on the intermediate level.
Yeah.
Where people are not even aware of it and they're relating to the actual. Mm-hmm. Okay. Any other thoughts or questions? Okay, I'm going to end with my question.
Oh, I'm struck by the percussion and the vibration aspect.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Yeah, sound can be very powerful in an imagery itself, right? Rhythm. Mm-hmm. Really the rhythm myself. Okay, I'm gonna end with Nietzsche. My favorite book from Nietzsche. One must still have chaos in oneself to be just a dancing star. I say unto you, you still have chaos in yourself.